So now that you've all been warned, not don't dare ask me a question during while I'm speaking. I actually would like questions. So if you have a question, pop it up. And if I think it's going to take too much time, he'll just yell at me later. So, so my name is Scott Mead. I'm a senior architect with OpenSCG. We are the open source consulting group. We do services and consulting around Postgres and other open source data tools. We're one of the platinum sponsors of the conference, so come up and say hello. We've got some cool things to show you. But what I'm here to talk to you today about is backups, right? So this is basic. Let's go over in Postgres, who, what, where, why, when. When it comes to backups and you're new with Postgres or with anything with backups, you always kind of feel like, well, I really would like to go fishing. I think I'd like to do some fishing from the beach, but I'm not quite sure how to do it. So my goal is to teach you how to fish. And I want to get you from here to, at the very least, here, where you feel like you can go out on a busy day on the water and be a fisherman or a woman. So that's the goal. I'm going to show you a couple of tricks and a couple of basic things you can do. You'll notice I'm going to do a couple of commands on the screen for you. I always forget the options to every Postgres utility. So I'll show you some of the ways to find them quickly and how to get to it. But what I really want to do is, at a high level, again, we're talking about backups. So on the agenda, no, this slide is not a testing slide. Number one for backups, and everybody always starts with how do I take a backup. Then they go to how do I restore a backup, and then they stop. So number one is testing. The most important thing you can do for your backups is test them, and test them frequently. I don't know how many times I've gotten into a place doing a health check or looking at whether it's Postgres or Oracle or a file system or something, and we realize that the last 2 months the backup was of size 0 bytes. Or it's on a 4 terabyte data store, the backup is 500 megabytes. There's something wrong. So testing and monitoring are the number one thing you need to be thinking about. And so what I want you to be thinking as we're going through how I take a backup, how do I restore a backup, what are the types of backups, all those things, always in the back of your head, have testing as number one, because it actually is the most important thing. I have a very good friend, I don't think he's here right now, guy with a big white beard walking around, his name is Peter Steinhauser. He's the grumpy old DBA that turned me into the grumpy old DBA I am today. And his favorite saying was, backups are like parachutes. If it doesn't work the first time, chances are you're not going to need it again. Right? So, making sure that you're testing frequently is important. And the thing about testing is not just testing it, but making sure that it's telling you when things are wrong. Now, if your test depends on a human or a set of humans every single day or every single week running these 10 commands in order and validating it, I guarantee that it's going to happen 3 times. They're going to do it 3 times, and then they're done. They'll never do it again. That's just human nature. Maybe it's DBA, sysadmin, lazy nature, but it's the way we are. So it's important that you take those things, you think about how am I going to automate them, and how am I going to have the automation tell me when there's a problem, okay? And now that I've said that, let's actually move on to some of the technical things, right? So when you're looking at backups, you've actually got a couple of, there's one really big choice you have to make. And you kind of have to look, do I have a copy? You have to make sure you've got a copy of the database somewhere. How much disk space do you need? It's an important one, right? A copy is a full copy of the database. You should have multiple. If you have 4 terabytes, you don't plan to have 5 terabytes. You plan to have 4 terabytes. Well, you plan to have maybe 6 terabytes for the master, 6 terabytes for the slave, 12 terabytes for backups minimally, and then you've got tape for offline retention and everything else. So you've got to plan way out ahead. So how much space do I have? And automation, 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 automation. Do not depend on anybody running a backup or doing the testing of those backups. Automate the living daylights out of them. They're very simple to automate. And you'll see as we get into the command line tools and how they work, how easy it actually is. Backups are one of those things. I grew up as a systems administrator, and so sysadmin, DBA, and then I played developer for a little bit too. But the one side of the house that backups really matter for is the business side of the house, and usually it's more so than the technical side. At the end of this talk, every single person in this room will be able to take a backup of any Postgres database anywhere on the planet like that. It's that easy. The question is you know, the business wants to know, how many days do I have available? How many days of backups are we keeping online? How long does it take to restore that backup? If I have a backup and it took me 12 hours to make that backup, but it's going to take me 18 to recover it, and that's my only strategy in the event of a failure, it's probably not going to fly with most businesses. So that's where we start thinking about what strategy we're going to pick. And then how much data can I recover? How much loss do I have? If I'm using certain type of backups, by the time it's done, it's already 42 hours old. It's kind of limited in its usefulness. So as we're talking about the different types of backups we can do, those are the kind of goals you want to be thinking about, right? And you kind of have to, at the end you'll see, you really have to marry multiple strategies together in order to get good backups. But we'll get into it. So from a technical side of view, from Postgres's perspective, right? I've talked about a lot of things, but we're here for Postgres. So Postgres has really two main types of backups. And these aren't just specific to Postgres, but this is what Postgres does. You have logical backups and physical backups. When you first start with backups, and usually if you've got a new app that you're deploying, logical is where everybody starts. It's simple, it's easy. A lot of tutorials do it. PGAdmin does it for you. A lot of great ways to easily get logical backups. Essentially, what a logical backup is, it's like doing a select star from every single table in your database and dumping that to a file. That's really what it is. You got to think the tools connect to Postgres as if they're a client, they're a C-based client. They select star from everything and they store it in a file. In addition to that, you're also getting all of the other meta objects. So you're getting what the create table statement looks like. You're getting any views, procedures, grants, permissions, anything you need to make the database go from zero to what you have is in those logical backups. The nice thing about logical backups, they're very highly portable. So what do I mean by that? If I take a logical backup from a Solaris machine, I can move it to a Linux machine. Linux 32. If I go from Windows 32, I can go to Linux 64. It doesn't matter. I can cross. It's basically just logical view of my data. There's a few tools that enable us to do this. All right. So here's the copy command. Copy is essentially, it's an underneath the covers. You'll very rarely, unless you're doing some stuff with ETL, most people don't actually get their hands directly into the copy command. But it's actually a server-side, very high-speed load and unload mechanism. So it'll basically take a table, simulate a select star from that table, but it dumps it out to a flat file on disk with, you know, a tab delimited or a CSV or whatever your delimiter is. You can use the command directly, and if you're doing ETL, I recommend you do, because it's the fastest way to get data in and out of Postgres. But the reason that I talk about it here is because all the remainder of the backup, the logical backup utilities that I'm about to talk about, use the copy command. So it's important that you know that it's there because it is pretty useful. It's nice if you ever needed, if you're ever writing reports and you just needed a quick CSV file that the business can open in Excel and do whatever they want with, copy command can do that for you. So take a look at the documentation. It's pretty nice. And it's got a lot of nice custom handlers. You can say, okay, for null data, quote it like this, or you know, however you want. There's a lot of flexibility. So backups. So before I actually talk about backup, there's one concept, and I build this as a beginner talk, so I'm going to keep this at a very high level. There's a very important concept in Postgres called MVCC. It's multi-version concurrency control. You can get into this with some serious math, some serious academic paper reading, and if you're really interested, pick up some relational calculus books sometime and have a fun read on a weekend. At a high level, what you need to know is multi-version concurrency control applies to every single statement that I run inside of Postgres. So when I run a select statement, what happens, MVCC gives me a snapshot so that if that statement takes 3 days to run, when it's done, it's going to look like it was when it started the transaction. So multi-version concurrency control gives me a snapshot when I start my statement or my transaction. The nice thing about the way Postgres does it is if you've got concurrent activity, reads and writes, and everything going on, you're not going to block one another. So if I have a 10 terabyte database that's going to take 3 days to do a logical backup of, I can do that while activity is going on in the database. When the backup's done, it's going to look like 3 days ago. when I started the backup, and that'll be consistent. You won't have missing foreign keys or anything. It's a consistent backup, and it runs live. MVCC is the super magic that makes all this happen underneath the covers. And there's a lot of talks and trainings that are available if you're interested in the guts of how that works, but it's a little bit much for this right now. So before I get into the actual utilities, are there any questions at this point? Cool, I've explained everything perfectly. All right, so the first tool to look at is actually a tool that I don't really recommend for most. By the way, just so you guys know, I know everybody's taking pictures of slides. Feel free. I'm also going to post them afterwards. So feel free, but if you don't want to, you don't have to. So, basically with pgdumpall, what this does, this connects to a Postgres database instance or a cluster, and it's going to dump all of the data in all of your databases into basically standard out. That's what it does. So if you run, you got to be careful with pgdumpall because you don't have as much flexibility with some of the other tools. But if we look very quickly, this is a Postgres database I have set up here. It's got a number of, let's do a /L, see if I, there we go. So I've got a number of databases in here. I really like making random names for things, but I've got a bunch of databases in this instance. If I run pgdumpall, it's going to basically copy all of the data from all of these databases into a single backup for me. That can be nice, right? It's the whole instance is backed up. It's great. I don't have a lot of options with it, though. I basically get kind of all or nothing. You can write a script and do a couple other things, but it's kind of limited in flexibility. The real reason that pgdumpall is important is because it's operating at that global level. pgdumpall is how you get backups of your users and your groups and your table spaces. So the magic switch to use is pgdumpall, and it'll scroll to the top of the screen in a second, globals.sql, minus G. Minus G is globals. This is really important that you do this, because what this does is this actually connects it. Like I said, it's not getting your data and your databases. This makes sure that the definition of your users and your table spaces and your groups, things that are global to that Postgres cluster, are backed up. So if you look at your globals, or my globals.sql, it's just a plain text backup. It's a SQL file that I can pump right back at the database. But it's got my roles, it has the encrypted, the hashed version of the passwords in it. And so I can restore this to another database instance and basically gain back those users. So a lot of people forget this step. This is usually the first step in my backup scripts, is a pgdumpall-g. It's a small file, and here it's only 28 lines. I only had a couple of users. It doesn't give a lot of data. But without this, if you try to back up your other databases individually, you're going to lose all this really important stuff, right? So for me, this is small, but some people have hundreds or even thousands of users, and being able to save the definition of that's important, okay? Pgdumpall-g is nice because it is only on the global objects, so it's very fast. So as you just saw here, this database is about 2.5 gig, but it's not scanning it, right? So you could run this live on most production Postgres databases and get something back very quickly, and you're backed up. So it's good. You know, a lot of this stuff doesn't change frequently. Some people go transactionally adding users and woo-ha, but most don't. Once a day is usually okay with this kind of stuff, but it is critical that you do it. Okay, so it's writing plain text SQL. It actually writes it to standard out. So if you just run it without the redirect like I did, it's actually just going to spit it right to the screen, which can be useful. You can pipe it through some things. You can play with it. It's nice. It's easy to read. The great thing about this is if you wanted, you could actually dump this, modify something, and then push it back to the database. So this is also a quick way if you can't remember. You know, I say teach how to fish. I don't remember the create role statement ever. So I run pgdumpall-g and look at what it's doing and then go write a version of it, right? So it's kind of a way to get quick help. It's a quick and easy way to do it. Okay. It can dump data too. So if I just ran pgdumpall with no flags, it'll dump every single row and every single one of my databases into that file, which would be a lot of fun for my 2.5 gig. But you know, when you get bigger, it gets a little scary. Okay. So okay, I've said use pgdumpall, but only for globals, don't use it for databases. How do I back up my data? That's what we're here to learn about. This is where you need pgdump. Pgdump operates not at that global level, but it operates on a single database in your Postgres cluster. So what we're going to do is we're going to turn on pgdump. We're going to say connect to database ABC, XYZ, Postgres, whatever it is, and dump the stuff out. Now, the really nice thing about pgdump's got a lot of nice things about it. First of all, it is as of 9.3, which hopefully everybody's on 9.3 at least or greater. I know not everybody is. But as of 9.3 plus, you get the option to do a parallel backup. So you can actually say, use 10 jobs and do the backup and actually run it a lot faster. It makes a really big difference. So it's a nice feature. But the other thing about pgdump is it's object selective. So what I mean by that is that, hey, I could either dump everything in the database, which is the default, or you know what? I really only want to dump the users table. So maybe I need to refresh dev, and I only need the latest users data. So I can do a pgdump and say, just give me the users table. Or I could say, give me everything except the users table. It gives you a lot of flexibility how you get your data out of the database. If you're not writing, it's kind of like the ability to write a select statement, store it all in a file, and move it without having to do that, right? You can just grab the data and go. And there's a lot of flexible output options. So the default is plain SQL, which you just saw me do. We'll do it in a second again. But just plain text file. You could take it, open it in an editor, modify it. A lot of times, if you're using standard stuff, you could take it and run it against Oracle or MySQL or, yeah, you would never do that. I mean, geez, but you could, right? So you can actually use pgdump as a method of schlepping data back and forth between different systems. With that, though, you know, plain text format comes with some side effects. It's plain text. So you also get the custom, I call it the compressed option, which creates a nice single backup file. Gives you a lot of flexibility, and I'll show you how we do that in a little bit. And you also get directory and tar format, which are very, very similar to the custom format. They just have a couple of different idiosyncrasies to them. So I'll show you how to use them all and what we can do. Okay. So how do we make a backup? Right. So what I'm going to do is pgdump basically is just a network client to Postgres. It's just a C-based client, connects into the database just like any other application would and runs some queries. So you need to give just about anything that connects to Postgres, you have to give it really four major things: the host, the port, user, and the password. Most of these things have defaults, or they have implicit defaults that are compiled in. You can set environment variables. And in this case, I'm just going to run, if I run pgdump format compressed or custom, that's that dash FC, so it's going to give me a custom format. Dash V is verbose. So basically, give me a status bar. What are you doing right now? What are you working on as you're doing the backup? And just like pgdump all, it writes it to standard out. So I'm just going to dump it straight into a file called demo.backup. Now, I just told you that you have to provide all these four parameters, but I didn't provide those four parameters, right? So there's some implicit things with the Postgres command line utilities. Here, it's actually, the host is local, or it's actually using a Unix socket, but it's basically, without a host being specified, it'll connect to your local machine. The port, it's connecting to the default. It'll use environment variables, or the default's 5432. The user, in my case, I've got it, it's Postgres, it's the default user's connecting, but you can switch which user. And the password, I have mine set up to not require passwords. It's a super secure laptop. But you can provide a password on the command line, or if you're automating these things, right? Whoa, wait a second, you just told me I have to automate everything and I can't put a password in the command line. You can use something called a pgpass file. So you can basically lock it up in a secure file in the user's home directory, and it'll do that for you automatically. Okay? So let's take a look at doing a backup. So if I go to my databases here, I'm going to list all the available databases I've got. I've got a couple. This Postgres database I've been running the Postgres benchmark tool, pgbench, inside of it. So if I look, this is a little bit messy output. But if I look at that specific database and say, let's see, Postgres database, where'd you go? I can't even read that. Here it is. Postgres database, it's about 1.5 gig. That's a messy output because the screen is a little compressed there. But so we're gonna do a 1.5 gig backup of this Postgres database. Let me move my terminal. I realize the terminal's a little squished here. Get all this junk off the screen. You can see pictures of my kids. all right. So what I'm going to do is pgdump format compressed or custom of the Postgres database. I want the verbose flag. I want to see a status, basically, what are you currently working on, and go into a file called postgres.bak. There's no really common extension. You can use whatever you want there. But this is actually a binary file it's spitting out. So what this is doing is telling me, okay, this is the table I'm working on. These are all the schemas. These are all the objects that I dumped out. And I can go through this log, and it'll show you if there's errors, they'll pop up here. This is really great for a small database like this. Yeah, question. It's a good question. I'll just give me 1 second. I'll get to that. The question is about what's the. Yep. Okay. So the question is about doing it this way versus doing it through like pgAdmin. Okay. So just give me 1 second. I get to see the status. This is really short little backup. But if I'm running a backup on a big database, it's nice to be able to see what it's currently working on. All right, so I can come back to it and say, okay, well, I'm backing up this table right now. I know that that's the largest table in my database, and it kind of gives you a mini progress indicator. What do I get when I'm done? With my compressed format backup, Postgres.bak is 29 meg. So I dumped 1.5 gig down to 29 meg. That's pretty good. Now, it's cheating because inside of that Postgres, in that 1.5 gig also has indexes. And my backup doesn't have the indexes. It just says, hey, you have to create an index here. So the backup isn't storing these large physical indexes. It's just storing the record of it. So you get some really awesome compression out of it. The problem with that is when you go to restore it, you have to rebuild all those indexes. They're easy to dump out. They're very fast to dump out. But the restoration is going to be a lot longer. So a lot of people will say, oh, well, hey, I took a backup the other day, and it took 45 minutes. How long is it going to take to restore? The answer is, who knows? and it's really around indexing. So the nice thing is when we do a restore, we can do it in parallel, and it will actually parallelize the create indexes as possible. So if you've got 64 CPUs and you give it a parallel of 15, you can create 15 indexes in parallel, which is kind of nice to be able to do. But that's usually with the logical backups. There's the other type of backup, physical, which we'll get to in a few minutes. But with logical, you're always unloading the data into a separate file. And when you want to restore it, you have to reload it. All right? So you're always going to pay that price with logical backups.
Is there any way to include a record count?
No. So that is a challenge. We talk about testing and validation of our backups. This happened at a client a little while ago. It's about a 2 to 4 terabyte, I don't remember the exact size, 2 to 4 terabyte database, and we did a PG dump and it came out to like 100 gig. Okay, I think that's okay. I know it's heavily indexed. The only real way to do it is to restore it. And then you got to do row counts, right? So I'll show you some other strategies for testing, but there's not a real good answer for that, especially for large databases. Question. No, you don't lose them. So it stores a record. So what it stores the create index statement. So it'll say inside of this backup, there actually be a line that says create index blah 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 blah. But the problem is for large tables, you have to actually create the index, right? Which is a pretty heavy operation. Yep. So this backup would give us a 100% restore, including the indexes. Yeah. I actually did, at one of these talks I did, something similar to that. I had somebody get up and run out and come back scared. It's like, no, sorry. Didn't mean to do that. So let's just look very quickly. So that's the compressed format, but I did tell you it's plain text SQL. It's easy to modify. So what does that look like? So I'm just going to get rid of that format compressed, just run pgdump. And I'm going to make this Postgres.sql, and it's going to dump out. It actually, the backup procedure itself can be a little bit quicker because you're not compressing. And there we go. So if I look at, let me just do Postgres star. So, oops, and make this human readable because it's as much fun as that is. So with this, the plain text SQL backup is 959 meg. So it's pretty close to the actual size of the database itself, whereas the compressed version is 29 meg. Right. So, and I'll show you, there's a couple other reasons why you should be using format compressed or format custom backups. There's a couple things you can do on restore that are lickety-split and cool. But it's harder to edit those. So if this one, I'm not going to do it because VI will not have a fun day, but you can open this with VI or a text editor and go, well, what the heck, right? While in Rome. So we'll open this thing in VI, give it a second or a minute. There we go. It's just plain SQL. So if I go and look for my data, so I hear it just see create type. So I had a custom type in that database. So it's got the create type statement. So if I wanted, I could copy and paste this and run it and use it. Or I could modify this, right? It's just a nice way to get a full backup. And you'll have all of your data will be in here as copy statements. So if we look for the string copy, there. So copy event log. So these are empty tables, but I would see my data would be right here with this backup. So there we go. So so I have a feedback table, and I've got a bunch of stuff in it. And that's actually all the raw data. It's tab delimited. So there it is. I can see it straight away. If I want to, with pgdump, I could actually have it dump it as insert statements. So if I wanted to use this to move, again, to a different database system or something, I could tell pgdump, hey, dump those as inserts, and it'll write insert into blah, 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 blah. The problem with the plain text backups, in some cases, you'll actually get to be larger than the actual database because it puts comments in there, it's putting spaces, it's putting all kinds of great things. So in some cases, you can actually get a much larger backup than your actual database based on what you're asking for. So this is where things get a little hairy. So we've talked about the different formats, right? We've got plain SQL, custom, which you've seen, directory and tar. They're just different flags you switch, and they look a lot like the custom backup. This is really critical, and I'm going to get to your pgAdmin question in just 1 second with this. But when I use a plain text backup, how do I restore it? You have to use pSQL or pgAdmin or any tool that can read SQL and send it to the database. When you use a custom directory or tar backup, you can't do that. You have to use the pgRestore program. It's a separate program. It drives me nuts that you have to do distinction between the two. pgRestore will actually, if you run it on a plain SQL, they'll say, hey, this looks like it's a plain SQL file. You should run that using pSQL. So it gives you a hint, but that's kind of the number. This is one of the things that really trip people up all the time. So plain SQL, use just a SQL interpreter. pSQL is the quickest way to restore. For any of the other formats, you want to use pgRestore. Okay? And no matter what you do, with all of these formats, you have the selective option available. So if I only want to take a backup of one table, I could just do dash T. So what I can do here, is I can say pgdump dash T pgbench branches from the Postgres database. And it's going to dump just the pgbench branches table and its data. So I'll get, there's, if you look at the SQL it creates, it actually gives me the create table. It fixes the ownership, and then it's got the table data. So it's got the copy command, and here's all the actual data for that table. So I was able to select just that one. It's kind of handy. I could also, if I use a capital T, I could dump everything except the pgbench branches table. And here's one of these areas where I want you to be this individual, right? Where we're learning to fish. There's a million options to pgdump. There's a million options to pgdump all, pgrestore, all of these. pgdump --help. It's got a great help menu that tells you all the options available. I'm not going to go over them all. I just want everybody to memorize dash dash help. And that goes for every command line utility in Postgres. So get familiar with dash dash help. It will make you feel like you can go fishing on any day, in any weather, and come up with something good, right? So so dash dash help. Okay. So with the compressed and the custom backup, why do I prefer using that? First of all, it's smaller. Second of all, you know, so we talked about the fact that I can say, I only want you to back up a certain table. But more often than not, something nasty will happen, not necessarily a whole database, but one table or a small set of tables. And so how do I just restore one table? I can't do that with a plain SQL backup. If I've got a multi-terabyte database and I have a plain text SQL, I can't open that in the text editor, just grab the one table and its data and replay it. This is the beauty of using the compressed format or the custom format, is if I run pg restore, what it actually does, it doesn't actually restore data. What it does is it converts that binary format into SQL. Okay? So what I can do is I can say pg restore list dash L everything in postgres.bak. And I get this beautiful table of contents that tells me all the different items that are in there. I can see if we can find the top. We have, you know, what the database name is, how many entries are in there, the compression level, the version of the, everything I could ever want to know about how the backup was taken, and all of the items that are in that table of contents. So now, okay, you know what? I had a problem. Let's use the PG bench branches table again. So let's just do, because I don't remember the option, we'll do dash dash help, right? We'll say, okay, I only want to dump one table. Oh, there it is, restore a specific table name, dash T. Same option as when I dump it out. So what I'll do is pg restore the single table called pg bench branches from postgres.bak. And this isn't going to put it in a database. It's actually just going to convert it to SQL and give it back to me. So I can extract from that dump the SQL for this specific table. I could tell it to go to a database if I want to, or I can dump it on the console. It's a lot of flexibility, sometimes too much. Question?
Can you dump it back into the database as a different table?
No. You would have to, I'll show you what you can, you'd have to kind of do it this way. The trick to that is just create another database, put it in there, and then slip it over. Question in the back. Yes, so what I would actually do is just say go to pgbenchbranches.sql, and now I have a file that will give me my pgbenchbranches table. Just a redirect, just a greater than. Yep, because it just dumps it on standard out. It's not doing anything else. Okay, so this is what the other flexibility that you get is, hey, you know what? I really want to dump, I just don't remember the create table statement for that thing. So this is another one of these times when the tools can be used for things they weren't necessarily intended for. I can say, give me the PG bench, bench branches table, and only the schema, and give it to me from postgres.bak. And now, instead of the data, I basically just get the create table statement. So I can very easily grab just the schema, or I could say, hey, just give me the data. I have either option. Question again. That's a good, blah, 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 blah. Let's take a look at, I don't remember which of the pgbench tables are indexed. No, it does not. I'm wrong. So when you look at the, if you look at the list, you'll have, here's storing the indexes as separate entities, basically. Okay. Okay. So that's how I can get. Now, what if I just want to dump that straight into the database? All I have to do is, remember, I got to give four things to connect to a database: host, port, user, password. Right. So I can say, okay, PG restore, I want you to restore the PG bench accounts, only the schema of PG bench accounts, and I want you to do it to the demo, or let's do, I use another one, Flyway demo database. So now if I go into Flyway demo and I look, I now have PGBench accounts, and I just did the schema. So I was able to extract it from a backup, load it to a different database, and I'm up. Now if I wanted, I could extract the data and do the same thing. Okay, question. So it's actually pgdump. Again, I don't remember the option off the top of my head, but there is an option for that, which is, here it is, dash capital C, include the commands to create the database. So that'll actually do it. So you just need to throw the dash C flag on it. Now, I said I was going to come back to the question. Somebody said, what's the difference of doing all this stuff versus using pgadmin? Zero. pgadmin, just if you go into the options menus of pgadmin, it says, give me the path to pgdump and pgrestore. So it's just doing exactly the same thing for you. The only difference that you're going to see actually comes along at the end with tips and tricks, right? So we're looking, okay, well, we're doing pgdump, but one of the things that pgadmin does is connects remotely. So the great thing about pgdump, it's just a network client. So I can have a backup server and run pgdump on it, connect to a remote database, and only copy the data over the wire one time. So a lot of people will run a pgdump on their server, and then they'll SCP or rsync the file to the backup server. That's an extra step. It's basically double copying the data. You can just run pgdump, connect to a remote server, just give it the IP address, and it'll just suck the data right over the network for you. So you can move the data once instead of multiple times. It cuts down on storage space too. Question?
Well, it might sound a bit ridiculous, but if you do the verbose on about, I think it's a 5 gig DB or so, there's actually a 30-second delay. It will take longer than just a normal dump.
Well, yeah. Depends. You'd have to look and see, because pgdump can use the format compressed. So if you use the uncompressed, it's going to be faster, right? So I believe pgdump by default makes compressed, or pgadmin. Okay. I don't use pgadmin. Yeah. I'm going to just give me a few minutes. We're going to move beyond questions. I know we got a couple more, but there is one other really. So that's logical backups, right? So I can basically unload the data from the database, store it in a file, take it to another server. Give it to my girlfriend and woohoo, off we go, right? We're happy. But there's a problem, right? And the problem, I already mentioned it, is that there's no way to predict what restoration time is going to be. It's because of the create index. When I start those, the majority of time with these things is usually index creation. I can parallelize it, but there is no way that I can go to management and say, hey, this thing took 45 minutes to back up. It could take 45 minutes or it could take 3 days. I don't really know. And you have to test it. And the thing is you test it once and it might behave one way. You test it a different time, it might behave a different way. So they're unpredictable. So the other problem is I am dumping all the data out, right? So what in the world can I do to get around this problem? And that's where we get to physical backups. So logical backups are great. They're simple, they're easy to do, command line utilities, they're available for Windows, Mac, Linux, Solaris, Uncle Bob's backyard operating system, whatever you want. Right? It's there, it's yours, go ahead. Physical backups are a lot harder. There's a lot more restrictions on them, but there's a couple of real key benefits to it. Okay? Essentially, a physical backup is a copy of the PG data directory. So when you're running a Postgres instance, it's got a data directory where it's storing everything. The simplest form of a physical backup is you stop Postgres, you copy that thing, then you start Postgres. You've got a backup. And the beauty of it is when you do copy it, this 2.5 gig, it's going to take a little bit more space than our 29 meg, but when I restore it, there is zero restoration time. All I'm doing is starting a copy of the instance. So if that database is 1.5 gig or 1.5 petabytes, it does not matter. It's going to just start the database. So restoration time is eliminated, right? Wonderful. I'm just going to do physical backups, except I can't stop the database. That's ridiculous. So this is where we use what's called PITR, point-in-time recovery. In training classes, when we do our point-in-time recovery lab, it's literally half a day. So I'm going to go through it quick. But you do need to know point-in-time recovery involves what feels like some duct tape and string and bubble gum and, you know, wishes and prayers, but it actually works very well. And if you haven't done point-in-time recovery yet, I recommend that everybody do it. And the reason is not just because it's good for backups, but what the procedures for taking a live, we call it a base backup. That's what you hear Postgres people say all the time is, I just take a base backup. That means a full physical backup. The reason that this is important is because physical backups are based on this technology, on taking this backup. Streaming replication is based on this. All the logical decoding and replication, BDR, which is coming down the pipe, all of that is based on this type of operation. So understanding how this works and being able to do it. It's a little complicated. There's some great wiki pages that'll walk you through step by step by step what to do. And there's a couple of utilities and tools to help I'll show you. But you really need to get very familiar with how to do this, because everything you need to do for running enterprise Postgres is based all on taking a live PITR backup. Okay? So what actually are we doing? So Postgres has these transaction logs, right? So when you take a physical backup, what you do is the first thing is you say, I want you to save all of your transaction logs somewhere. And then while Postgres is running, no, you don't have to quiesce traffic, you don't have to stop anything, full-blown go at it mode. You're archiving transaction logs, you just start a copy of the data folder. Use operating system command, copy, SCP, rsync, use LVM snapshots, use, well, ZFS snapshots. Technically, you don't have to go through all this rigmarole, but the idea is you, any way that you can take that data folder and copy it, do it. And when the database is done copying, it's going to be an inconsistent pile of mess, right? But what we're going to do, the restoration procedure, is basically going to point at these archive transaction logs, and it's going to replay and get consistent, right? So it's a very, very easy way to get your backups done and made, and it does it physically. There's a couple of nice things. The reason that restoration's so fast, you're not unloading the indexes. They're physical files. It's great. It's easy to do. And then, like I said, this is the basis for doing, whether you're doing log-based replication or streaming replication, all of it comes from this standard procedure. And you're up and running the entire time this is happening. The other important thing about this is not just the fact that we're backing everything up and restoration time is fast. Remember we talked about MVCC back when I started, and I said, when you start a query, the query is consistent as of when the query started. So if I take a PG dump of a 2 terabyte database, let's say, and it takes 12 hours to complete for whatever reason, by the time it's done, my backup is 12 hours old, right? So my backup is only good as of when it started. It's useful, but it kind of stinks. With physical backups, when your backup is done, your backup is consistent as to when you stopped your backup, but even better than that, when you flip a flag, you're now replicating, you can actually go beyond that and catch up. So that physical backup you take, you can restore to any PITR, point in time recovery. I can actually say, hey, you know what? Developer XYZ typed drop table accounts at 12:52 p.m. So I want to tell my backup, I want you to roll forward to 12:51 and 59 seconds, and you can recover the data. So that's how granular. You can get even more granular than that if you know the transaction ID. You can get to 1x ID before he blew the, or he or she blew that accounts table. So it's very, very fine grained. The issue that you're going to run into with physical backups, there's a couple. One of them is you're tracking every single log file. You have to keep in track. Yeah, keep track of it. Sounds great. Doesn't sound like it's too bad. They're 16 meg in size. They're not that bad, right? How bad could it be? I've got a customer that flies through 4 terabytes of transaction logs times 9 instances of Postgres every single day. So storing those bad boys, you got to plan. You really got to be ready for it. And the other problem with physical backups are wonderful, but when you're backing up the physical structure of something, if it's corrupted, you just backed up your corruption too. Right? So when you're doing those physical backups, you're just copying blocks on the disk. If one of those or 10 of those are really screwed up and messed up, you just copied your corruption, right? So, okay, now wait a second. We just went this whole route of you got to do physical backups. They're great. They get you in the backup. There's all these things you can do with them. You can do replication with them. But now you're telling me that it's, you know, it's got this problem where I'm storing corruption. So how do I deal with it? What I want you to do is combine physical and logical backups, right? And here's why this is important. If you take a physical backup, let's say you take a physical backup on a Monday, and then you can do incremental backups. With physical, you can do incremental backups every day of the week. At the next week, before you delete those old backups, you restore it, and you do a PG dump from it. And why do you do that? What does PG dump do? It does a select star from every table in that entire database. That basically runs through all of your data. And if there's an error, if there's a block error in one of those blocks, you'll see the error message. And then you can start going back through your old backups with your point-in-time recovery and roll forward to before that error message and recover your database and get to a sane state. So that's why testing is so important, right? So we're talking about testing last, but you actually have to combine these two strategies on large databases. Make sure you're testing and make sure you're reporting them. That way you know your backups are good. Right, because with logical backups, maybe you know 29 meg versus 1.5 gig, I don't know, that's not good. When I do physical, the size should match. And if I do a PG dump, I can actually run through every single block in the entire database and validate that the backup looks like it's good, or it's at least not corrupted. So it's important that you do that, okay? I ran through a couple of slides quickly, but the how-to on configuring physical backups, it is complicated. I'm not going to lie to you. There's a tool called PG-based backup. It's actually shipped with the server. Take a look at it. It does some stuff for you. You have to configure archiving ahead of time. You've got a bunch of other settings you got to set. There's a couple things to do, but it's a worthwhile exercise. It'll probably, if you've never done it before, it's probably going to take an hour to 2 hours to do it. Definitely worthwhile. And if you're banging your head on the wall, you're right there. You're in the right spot. Okay. Essentially, the procedure is, so when you get to replication, right, essentially the first step is take a physical backup and then restore that backup and connect to the master. It's just with a little recovery.conf file, how you control that, okay? So logical backups, fast, portable. You can select what you're putting in and taking out of the backups. Restores are kind of slow. Physical backups, it's flexible. I'm sorry, it's not a flexible restore. That's a bad bullet point. What that's supposed to say is physical backups, you don't get the chance to choose what tables you want. It's all or nothing. So you can't say, I want to take a physical backup of this 1 meg table. You got to take the whole database in order to get that. But restoration is very, very, very fast. It's just starting the instance. And if you have a lot of logs to replay, like let's say you've got 24 hours of logs, you've seen 24 hours of logs go in 5 minutes, right? It's very fast to replay them. And then with physical, you also get differential and incremental options. So if you use a couple of tools like PG Backrest, which is a really great PG Backup and Restore, it's a great tool that actually will automatically take those physical backups for you. It'll let you restore them, and it will do differential and incremental, so it'll save you some space. The joke is that every consulting company has their own backup and restore tool in the Postgres community, which is kind of true. Some cool ones like Wally. So PG Rman, if you're used to Oracle, it's a very Rman-like interface. Wally is it actually will store your transaction logs up in Amazon S3 for you. So if you're worried about planning for that and you got an S3 bucket that you can have at, it'll actually send them to Amazon for you. My personal favorite is PG Backrest. It's very flexible. It's very fast. Question?
By the way, we're adding S3 support
to Backrest?
Yeah.
There you go. So Amazon S3 support to PG Backrest. Woohoo! That's a happy day. So take a look at all these tools, because you really do need to go through the procedure of setting up that backup, setting up that replication once, because then you'll really have a love and appreciation for all these tools. The other thing is if you're using like Amazon RDS, they do all the replication for you, right? So you, that then you really gain a love and appreciation for that. Bless you. Those are the different types of backups you have. Hopefully, we went from the fisherman on the beach to being comfortable on the water to being able to rip whatever we want from the bottom of the ocean. There's just one thing I caution you. As you spend time with databases, like myself, I've been doing this about 15 years now. You kind of get a little bit bitter. Whatever you do, don't become this guy. All right. If you have any questions, I'll post these slides up. You'll see them. There's a spot for posting all of them. Feel free if you have any questions, let me know. And I think that's time. Thank you, everybody.